VOV 91.3. Voices of Voiceless, we in the house. I'm Nate Peter Ghost, Barak King X, Kunta Kinte, 1 foot off.
Same Mike, Michael J. Thriller. Mike talk a lot, Negro spiritual, beautiful mind, Jesus crack, Mike camera action in the building.
What's going on? VOV, Voice of the Voiceless, it's your man Keefe, Laporte, aka Sir Lord Kees the Thor, aka Kees the Life, the one man team.
And I'm Trooper Joe, and I'm here to keep it real for you.
Tune in to Voice of the Voiceless every Tuesday, 12 to 1.
Century, I guess, right? Is it? I don't know. Because they said that about Barak.
The most complicated, I think.
The most complicated, maybe. Maybe most complicated, I would say. I mean, I hate the same thing all the time. We got two bad candidates. It's like, I'm hearing this all the time. The lesser of the two evils, or the evils of two lessers, whatever you want to put it.
Okay, I don't go with lesser of two evils and all that. They both stink. That's all I can say. They're both. The only agenda that they have in mind is their own. You know, people get ready. There's no change coming.
You said there's no change, or is it going to be a lot of change?
The only change that's going to come is in a negative kind of way. I don't see anything positive coming from either one of these two. It's all about them. Has little or nothing to do with
the America. Yeah.
Yeah. I just can't find it.
Yep. So I don't know. I went this morning and voted, and that was the two questions I was asking myself as I'm walking in to vote. Is one, why should I vote? And it made sense to me because I'm an American. I'm proud to be an American. It gives me a sense of pride. You know, so, but in order to, and then what kicked in is how do people hear your voice? By voting. But how do your voice get heard? And I think it goes by how much people you're with or how much money you got. So it was tough. But, you know, I rather, told you on the show before, I'd rather see a female president. First female president. Of the United States. That's it. That's like, you know, voting for the black man.
Hey, shouts out to Sean. He said, hope you guys got your purge kits ready.
Purge.
Yo, I was watching.
Purge. So I went down there today. I'm just going to tell you how my feelings was. My feelings this morning was like, let me get up and do this. So I get up and I get dressed. I go down there. I'm at the voting booth. A lot of Trump supporters. They're vocal. They're down there like, hey, Trump, you know, boom, and he speaks how he feels, and Hillary doesn't do that. He speaks his mind and all that thing, right? So I got a lot of other people down there having Trump shirts and everything. But the Hillary voters is really silent, and I don't know how many Jill Stein or the Johnson guy that's running the third parties, but I don't know. It was scary. I don't know. You think you voted for Johnson? You just close your eyes and just pick one.
Yeah,
that's what he said.
It's
right?
One of those elections.
It's bad. You know, it's like I was hurt to go down there to vote because it's like I can't find good in either one of these two top candidates and stuff, and that really makes me mad.
It was like filling out an NCAA bracket. You just start just filling out names and stuff on teams and stuff. I like the color blue.
Yeah.
That one. All right, so
then that was the second question. Why should I vote for, you know, who am I voting for? And that's crazy because none of them have our interest in their intentions. Why do we vote for them? You know what I mean? And is that a reflection of us not being, or a majority of the people not being part of this voting process for so long that it gets to this point that when it comes to a candidate, none of them are talking like realness. None of them are even, you know, making sense of any of the issues that are happening in America or internet, you know what I mean, internationally.
They're not making sense at all. I was looking, and you know, I still had my fingers crossed that there was going to be a place on that ballot that said, let's cancel this whole election because this is stupid, and let's get some people in there ready to do it again.
I know, but you can't, though. You can't, though.
What's going on? It's your boy, Truth It. All praises to Jehovah. I voted Hillary because Hillary, Donald Trump had Rudy Giuliani, the person who came up with Stop and Frisk, and a lot of stuff he's saying, like, you know, that black guy should have got roughed up. So I figured I'd just go with Hillary, and if Hillary doesn't do what I expect her to do, the things that she says she's going to do and things that she claims she's changed about, like about black people healing, kneeling, like dogs or whatever, if she doesn't, then 4 years I'm just voting for the other person. It's easy. It's not a big deal.
All right. I hear that.
As for me, this is your boy Joshua Kennedy representing Learn Today, Lead Tomorrow, Liberia. As for me, though, like I said earlier, I'm more focused on the local voting because those are the voting that impact us immediately. Everybody, whether you have you like Hillary or you dislike Donald Trump or you don't like Hillary, it doesn't matter. Make sure you vote locally. Vote number two, vote number four. Number four especially, but make sure you vote very, very, because it's effective. Those are the things that really affect us, and it comes to the point that those things affect us immediately. So as for Hillary and Donald Trump, I believe that having a female president for the first time is an amazing thing for America. Having a man who was once on Apprentice, and he was on Apprentice, and now he was talking about fire, but now running for president, I feel like it speaks to the greatness of America, that anybody, regardless of who you are, where you come from, that you can become president of this great nation. So it's a great election, but local voting is the main key.
If that's what it is, right, the image of being the president is top dog in America, in the world, is being the president of America. Doesn't it water down that position when you start to put more and more people there at that position of president, you know, and they don't do nothing? So telling your daughter or your son who might be an African American, saying that, yes, there was a president named Barack Obama, you can be anything you want to be, the president is not going to be that position.
What are you talking about? He's Barack Obama with that. I mean, like,
I like Barack Obama.
I think that's epitome of saying that you can be anything.
Yeah, you can tell
you
a young black kid, yes.
I don't think it watered down the presidency when Barack was in there. Now, we talking about somebody with Donald Trump who doesn't have no history of being involved with no public office. Nope. Then you might start saying, oh, then I can see Kanye West being president in 2020. You know what I'm saying? Because when Donald Trump he comes for president, then it's like that. But I mean, at the same time, man, I think that where people are scared and are coerced into voting for either one of these parties these days, because the third parties, I think we should give a lot more light to these days and time, because I mean, Democrats and Republicans have been presidents for the history of America. So I think we should give a third party a shot, because they've been sucking a whole lot. I mean, like, Barack Obama did a pretty good job as far as presidents go, I guess. But for situations and issues that have been going on in America for extensive a long time, for years, he haven't addressed those. I mean, like, you know, poverty and, you know, I don't know, there's no magic wand for these things, but I don't know. He did his good job as far as presidents go, but I don't know. I think we should move on to a different part.
Yeah. Time for a change. I like that. I could dig it, but at the end of the day, neither changes are either, you know, organized or even have evolved as the Democratic or Republican Party. So I don't know. I don't know. It's all about pick a side, right? Which side you on? Because I know last week's caller, that was his suggestion. If you don't like Democrat or Republican nominees, you can mess it up by giving another party their vote. You know what I mean? Because they get 5% of the vote, makes them a legit party. So maybe it's time for a change.
Yeah, that's what I think we need to focus on. Like, you know, even if people say, like, you know what, it's going to be a lost vote. That's going to be a vote for Donald Trump if you vote for Jill or Johnson, whatever. Dang, that's messed up. You know what I'm saying? That's the only thing I can say about that. But the only way to get the third party on the ballot, you have to get more than 5% of the votes this year.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? For them to be a credible party.
And I think this year is a good year to get 5% of the votes because of voters, you know, being so, you know, separated, segregated, as far as now all of a sudden you're hearing a lot of people say the lesser of two evils, and it's like that's what we've been, a country that's been a lesser of two evils. So you know, what do you do now? You know, you don't want to go for lesser of two evils. If, like, I remember my option was give an empty ballot, but now there's other options, another party.
I'm not buying all that good stuff like that.
What, another party?
I don't think another party really gonna do anything. I think the two parties we got now, we have a two-party system. That's fine. What we got, I believe, personally, we have a lot of uneducated, and not uneducated in the scholastic way, uneducated in a feeling type of way towards what they want out this country. They're all working off of passion, and their passions are fueling a lot of anxiety.
Yeah.
And because of all this anxiety with their passion of what they want personally and everything, all the other issues aren't being addressed. Those two should have never reached the pinnacle that they're at now, especially Donald Trump. He was running against a powerful bunch of men that would have been good candidates to be leading this country. I think he was the most shocked person in America when he got the nod to run for the presidency. Yeah. Yeah? Because people were voting their passion, and their passion was fueled, like I said, by anxiety. And those two together, they don't make rational decisions, and that's what we're stuck with now. So to say that, the lesser of two evils, what is the lesser of two evils? Is dying by a bullet, that's one evil. Is dying by getting hit by a Mack truck or drugs, that's some other evils. The ultimate thing is you're dead.
Evil topic, I want to talk about the, what's that? The no on two, yes on two.
No, yes on two.
I went down there to the voting thing. I couldn't even make a decision, yo. I couldn't even vote yes or no on either way because it's the lesser of two evil thing again. Yeah. It's crazy. It's like saying, like, okay, public schools suck. We all know that. If we vote yes, it gives charter schools more money, and there's going to be maybe one charter school in Worcester because only 12 charter schools are going to get that money. In Massachusetts, so maybe Massachusetts don't even get a charter school. You know what I mean? You gotta think about that. And then you gotta think about, you know what, charter schools are doing good. I wanna support charter schools. I wanna, you know, make more charter schools in Massachusetts because they're doing well. I know a lot of kids, parents that say nothing but good things about charter schools and what they do to their kids. And on the other hand, we have thousands of kids that go into public schools that might have to get some money taken away from them because to support the charter schools. So I don't know, man. It was a hard one, so I couldn't even decide.
Yeah, this one was the easiest one for me. Basically, I've had conversations with people who say, "Oh, why don't you join the PTO if you have a problem with public schools?" Public schools aren't the problem; it's the parents. The reason why these kids aren't graduating is because of the parents. So if the public schools, this is the argument that I've gotten from people who think public schools should get the money. So if it's the parents, why should I give more money to public schools? Is that going to make parents come in and start doing their job for the kids? No. Until public schools and I can have a conversation where they can explain to me how schools like Burncoat High School can be one of the most disgusting schools still, and they're doing nothing to improve it or nothing to change it, then I have no problem voting for or giving money towards schools that actually care about their kids. But Burncoat, schools like Burncoat do not care about their kids.
Well, I got a question for you, Truth It.
Yep.
Because that's not even the real deal about this. Mm-hmm. We know, like, we know the schools are doing bad.
Right.
We know they need improvement. Everybody knows that.
Right.
I mean, you can pick other schools, level 4 schools that was in Worcester. Like, I think Elm Park Elementary School is still a level 4 school.
Yeah.
And they've been level 4 school for like over like 5 years now.
Right.
Right. So we know that. So you're just willing to make a sacrifice. That's what you're trying to do right now. You're just sacrificing because you're going to have thousands of kids that's probably going to have less access to different things in public schools because of that. Mm-hmm. Maybe after school programs might get cut. Maybe some school won't get new books and new papers and pencils that they need for the duration of the day. Schools.
Right.
Or maybe some teachers might get their salaries cut and some teachers might get fired or whatever.
Right. Like I said off the air, it reminds me of a crackhead family member. You have to let them hit rock bottom until they realize, wow, we got to stop blaming everybody else in every other circumstances, and we need to focus more on actually getting these kids their education and not doing things like bringing in police to arrest them and throw them in jail for the rest of their lives, or care about every other thing besides these kids learning how to do stuff in school like they do at charter schools.
Hey, do we have a no one two somewhere around here? Do we have a no one two? Because I want to get the rebuttal, because like I can't go against that, because that's the reason why I didn't vote for that, because I side with Will a whole lot, and I do side with the fact that some money's gonna get cut from public schools. Like, I got two kids in public schools.
Me too.
So that's like almost saying, like, you know what? Hey, man, you guys might have a bad school next year, the next 4 years, whatever.
So I remember about a couple months back reading an article, and I shared it with y'all about a town in America that took their taxpayers' dollars and invested it in Nestle to produce their water for the state. Nestle, they, you know, I guess they're invested in producing purified water, good water. And they did that with taxpayers' dollars instead of saying the public, instead of saying DPW to provide us our water. So I remember when I was saying that, I was drawing comparisons in as far as why can't people who pay taxes decide where their money goes, you know, to, I guess, kind of reform this public structure or systems that, you know, aren't giving good education outcomes for the bottom of the barrel, that aren't giving good health outcomes for the bottom of the barrel, and that aren't even representing in the justice system at the bottom of the barrel. So it's like paying, you know what I mean, taking your taxpayers' dollars and saying, listen, all right, instead of me investing in this public system or this public education, public health care, and public judiciary system, let's pay people to get outcomes. And that's how I looked at it as far as even with charter schools. It's like, all right, let's take the taxpayers' dollars and put it in something different, like you were talking about as far as a change. But it needs to be, like, all across the board. It needs to be a change, because at the end of the day, you still have the bottom of the barrel the same.
I just want to respond to Keith real quick.
Okay, Keith, I'm a bot too.
One thing about having stuff privately owned, privatized, because you're moving from public to privatized, right? So now, this is not even really what, this is information I'm getting, the pros and cons of this, so it's not really my thoughts. It's something I read. And it was just saying that, you know, so the person who owns the school and owns they make the policies of the school. So a lot of times they can make, so if you have somebody that's being unfair to people, they kind of can keep it that way because they're the owners of the school. You know what I'm saying? As far as public schools, you can take that to the school committee and they can make changes on things that might be not right or correct. So that's the pros and cons of that.
And yeah, and I, like I said, I dig your argument with the private and the public. I just feel charter, from my experience, you have more parents involved. You have more teachers, staff involved. So that's, you know, I would say yeah if I didn't see different. So I'm seeing the parents come to the school every day, not just to pick their kids up, to talk to the teacher, to talk to the principal, the superintendent, and get personal with them. So, and I know Dante was trying to bring up that fact, but that's a total lie. And in retrospect, you talk about the school committee, and no, we had Tracy Novak here on the show in the past tell us all they talk about is relevant topics, what's trending. They don't deal with none of the real problems, why, let's say, young men of color have been underperforming for the past 40 years in Worcester. No, they don't talk about that. They talk about what's trending. And all I'm saying is, from what I've seen in charter, is that you are more involved. And if it's your taxpayer dollars that are going to this school, let's say charter schools, I see that being more of a system that parents can be involved in rather than this same public school system that's telling people to come to PTO meetings. That I went to a parent board meeting for schools the other day. It was like five parents, and it was for all parents in public schools. So you understand what I'm saying? I see the difference.
Make some great points, though, man. How about you, Tripp? You got something to
I gotta agree with everybody. I think the system of education in this country is the real problem. If there was a way to take and improve the public school system in the near future, then we should do that. Because the near future is for the kids. The kids are going to be the ones that's going to govern and run this country in the end. They're not prepared. The public school isn't preparing kids to go out there and stand on their own. Nor is the charter school. The charter school is focused on academics, And that's giving some of the kids who have a good feeling about themselves an ability to go out there and take leadership positions and do those things. But the charter school spoon feeds the kids and they baby the kids, so they're taking away a lot of that kind of risk factor that the kid will need when he goes into the real world. The public school, from what I see, they're just not doing it. One of their major complaints is, I'm underpaid. It's like, what do you mean you're underpaid? You don't have to be a teacher. You went into this to be a teacher because you wanted to get into a big hot thing and you wanted to do something good for the kids so that this country has a better future. So don't complain if your $100,000 a year isn't enough for you to live off.
You decided that profession.
It's probably like 60. Y'all stop bugging. They need to get paid more. We need to invest in the teachers because the teachers can be able to support the schools and to support the kids. Because a lot of times these kids gotta, so the teachers gotta work overtime to convey the message, or so the kids needs more time, they gotta work overtime, and sometimes they don't get paid and they gotta do over hours. That's a good teacher. I think they should be compensated for the work that they do. They should get paid a little bit more money.
I'm not thinking they only get 60,000. I think they get around an 80 or 90,000 dollars.
I think they
make a goodly amount of money
to live off.
And they don't work a full year. So I think they do quite all right.
And then when they don't work, they get unemployment.
And I think one of the problems that happened in the public school was that the school, the school didn't keep up with the technology and the science.
That's what I wanted to bring up.
You know, the teachers, they're not qualified to teach that. They're qualified to teach the stuff that I learned 60 years ago. You know, they were taught by my generation, and they were taught the stuff that my generation knew. And then all of a sudden, the world exploded with technology and stuff, and because of social media and the amount of information that was just funneled, it wasn't even funneled; it was just poured upon people and stuff. And I don't believe the teachers were able to keep up in the public school, so they were teaching stuff that wasn't relevant to the kids' future.
All right.
So that's changing.
To my point, what Troop was saying.
After this, we're gonna move on.
We have kids that are being taught with an old style of teaching, and it's very generic. It's not feeding or nurturing this, how do I become a better teacher? And you see that though when in charter schools on them doing different things so these kids can learn. And I don't want to make it a public private type of argument, because my thing is if we're the taxpayers, we are involved in the system, like we can talk about what we want for our money, you know. Now you're talking about taking taxpayers' money in a public system and hiring something, you know, hiring systems to come and replace these bad systems, you know? So then when you talk about now being innovative and pushing, let's say, the needle on you being a better worker or you being a better student, you have that support now because that competitiveness now is there when you talk about private. Like now you have a teacher who's willing to go above and beyond and make sure that it's we, not me, you know, and I. It's we got to get these kids to learn. We got to get all these kids on the same page. And they try and do different things to get these kids on the same page. Not right now in the public, as I see it, is if you ain't ready to learn, you're going to miss the bus. And I think that public schools have been sending that message forever, that there's this air of, I'm sending my kid to school to learn. That's been gone, you know. There's this hidden message now that I was telling you that I learned, that you have parents who, if they really cared about their kids, not only are they reading to them, they're sending them to different schools. They're paying for their education.
Yeah. So, you know what? Just a little quick bumper break. 1 foot off. I'm in the house. Baraking X.
It's your man, Keith Laporte, a.k.a. Solo Keys the Door. Keys to Life. One man team.
Now I'm Trooper Joe, and I'm here to keep it real for you.
And I'm Joshua Kennedy, and I'm here representing Learn Today, Lead Tomorrow Liberia, a nonprofit organization based in Worcester, Massachusetts.
And we have Trooper over there who ain't saying anything. Yeah, his glasses are most educated.
All praises to Jehovah.
Jehovah.
He said Jehovah. You know, well, Jehovah is God. What you mean? God, Allah.
Jehovah.
God, Jehovah. Got a million. How many names does he have, they say?
Yeah, all you want. Hey, let's talk about Liberia. You think? Want to talk about Liberia?
Yeah, I want to go in and talk about Liberia. What's all about?
Come on. Liberia.
Okay, all right. So, I'm here representing Learn Today, Lead Tomorrow, Liberia. We are a nonprofit organization based in Worcester, Massachusetts. We are a 501c3 organization trying to empower the next generation of leaders through education. Education is the key to success, so that's the reason why we believe that in order to change Africa, you have to educate the next generation. And we are having our launching program December 3rd at 60 Mason Street in Worcester, Massachusetts. So just a little background, I came to the United States in 2000. I went to Forest Grove Better School, I went to Doherty, and I went to Norfolk. I consider Worcester to be my home. I've been in America for actually half my life. So I'm 29 years old and I came here when I'm 12, so you can do the math. I'm not good at math. But, so I consider Worcester to be my home, and I truly believe the people of Worcester are great and amazing people. I live in Worcester since I came to the United States, and I've encountered amazing people in school and everywhere, my working place, everything that I do. I'm passionate about helping the next generation. That's why my work, what I do professional for work, I'm a social worker working at Department of Children and Family. I help to take care of children in Worcester and around the community, just to making sure everybody is safe. And in Liberia, we are working, trying to bring change, and education is the way. So we are asking you guys, please come and join us December 3rd, 60 Mason Street at the Redemption Christian Church in Worcester, Massachusetts. Come and learn what we are doing in Africa. We have built a school thus far, and we are trying to complete the school. The school is 90% completed. We are working hard. Together, we can bring change to Africa. But the only way we can bring change is if we act, because actions speak louder than words. So please remember, 60 Mason Street, Worcester, Massachusetts. This is Joshua Kennedy representing Learn Today, Lead Tomorrow, Liberia. I hope to see you all there. God bless.
So how much Liberians in Worcester, roughly, you think?
I think there is a large population of Ghanaian. There is a large population of Ghanaian in Worcester, but there is a significant population of Liberian as well. So I'm guessing roughly, this is just an educated guess, I'll probably say roughly about 4,000 or more in Worcester, Massachusetts.
All right. You told us a little bit about the program earlier.
Yep.
I don't necessarily have a problem with this, but I kind of have a gripe. I don't know.
Okay. So go ahead. I like gripes.
Because you're saying you're gonna. So we still have people in Liberia that go to with the public schools or charter schools or whatever, and you wanna sponsor them, do the course of their high school career or do the course of their.
So basically, it is approaching the Worcester Public School, basically going to Worcester Public School and asking them if they can identify students in the Worcester Public School who are of Liberian descent, and approaching them to making sure that if we can sponsor them in a mentorship way, just a mentorship, because leaders, Africa need leaders right now. Everywhere, even America right now, as look at the president, we all need leaders though. But I truly believe it is identifying the leadership skills, because every individual that you meet in life, they are intelligent. Just, there are people who are street smart, there are people who is book smart. But it is identifying what their strengths and their weaknesses are.
All right, so that's not my gripe. That's the beauty of that program. Okay. The mentoring, I love that.
Okay.
The part where I'm kind of like, I get off when you said, then they go back to Africa.
Yeah,
it's like they get their skills, they go back to Africa. We need them to stay here.
it's not that go back. They'll be volunteering a portion of their time to go back and donate a portion of what they have learned to the people of Liberia. So they're not going there. They are citizens of the United States. This is their home. But it just, they seem, let's say, going back to do a missionary work to see if they can empower the next generation of leaders in Liberia. So basically, this is their home. They're not going back, but they'll be helping people in Liberia and around the world.
Let me ask a question real quick.
I got it. So, and my thing is, I hear everyone throw the word around loosely. seriously, what's a leader? What's a leader to you? What does a leadership or leaders mean to you? You know what I mean? What does that mean?
That's a very good question. It's a very, very good question. To me, a leader is somebody who truly believes in a cause. Martin Luther King is a leader because he believed in a cause and he was willing to die for the cause. I believe Gandhi is a leader. He believed in a cause. He was willing to die for a cause. To me, a leader is somebody you don't necessarily need to have the scholastic aptitude or to be educated in certain aspects. But if you're passionate about something and you're willing to go forward with it, like Learn Today, Lead Tomorrow, Liberia, we believe that every child deserves to learn in Africa and around the world. So we are working to empower them. And I'm passionate about helping children. That's why, like I said earlier, actions speak louder than words. So if you look at my professional life, I work helping children in America. And you look at my passion, I want to help children back in Africa. That is what passion is, and I truly believe that's what leadership means.
All right. My question is, you mentioned DCF. You said you work for DCF? I think you know where this question is going. Then you might not. So you see a lot of broken homes of
yes,
youth, especially, and they're non-Liberians, a lot of them that you see.
Yes.
Why is this open to all walks of life in Worcester, or is this just specific to Liberians?
Well, this is open specifically to Liberia because I've always believed in this analogy. You cannot go into another man's home and try to tell him to clean his home if your home is dirty. So my belief system is, you have to clean your home before you go into someone else's home. I was born and raised in Liberia. Therefore, in order for me to speak on a larger scale to say you can bring change to America, I must try to bring change to Liberia because that is where I'm from.
And so you don't think it's possible to do both?
I think it's possible to do both, but like I said, in order to, you have to start somewhere before you can go forward. But that is a long-term goal. But as of right now, I truly believe that you have to clean your own house before you can go into the next man's house to clean his house. Because in my house, it's very, very dirty. Like I told you, Liberia was the worst country for primary education. The worst. It's the top country for worst, and we came from two civil wars. The country, there is many people who deserve and they are yearning for education. That is the reason why we are working to impact and bring change to Liberia and Africa as a whole.
All right, so yeah, the Bible says take the speck out of your eye before you try to talk about the twig exactly. In someone else's. So I dig it. I understand
definitely,
what you're saying.
Definitely.
I like it. I appreciate
man,
it.
Man, come on with that Bible. You got a word, right?
I got it. Just how everything, you can find something in the Bible to relate to something.
Definitely, yes.
I got a comment. My wife right now, she's in Haiti, right?
Mm-hmm.
She's at a clinic we do in Haiti. And the kids in Carpathia went on strike because the infrastructure of the school system, this is what the kids organizing, and the little kids and stuff, they're on strike right now because the school system over there in Haiti, in Carpathia, isn't doing what it's supposed to do. Some of the problems are structural to the buildings, the leaking there and going through some torrential rains right now, but is this a similar type of problem over there in Liberia that has been brought about by the amount of NGOs that's going over there, you know, and trying to do this type of work for bring the school around, but really they're going over there to appease their own self-conscious on, I have to do something for the world because I have to give back?
To be honest, I'm not too knowledgeable in that area to speak extensively to see what is going on, but based on my own personal opinion, UNICEF, like I just said, the United Nations has been involved in Liberia for over 30 years.
Yeah.
And Liberia has been through two civil wars that lasted almost 18 years. The last civil war just ended in 2003. So there's almost like 300,000 people who have lost their life due to reasons that is not even, you can't even fathom it, just for reasons doesn't even make sense. But there is a lot of deplorable children. People in Liberia live on $2 a day. $2. Mm-hmm. Imagine you living on $2 a day.
No, I live in America. That ain't gonna happen.
Exactly. But I'm just saying though, and I truly believe, because I was blessed, right? And I give everything that I have in life, I give it to God. Because without God, my presence here will be unknown. So because of what I've been through, and the little opportunity that I truly have been given, the opportunity to go to Doherty, and now when I got my associate
Consignment when I got my bachelor's at Worcester State. Now I'm working to get my master's degree at American International College. It is a blessing. And it truly the greatest gift you can do in life is to give to others. That is the greatest gift. Because I learned by Dr. Jordan, who is the Seven Hills. I was at a conference and he said, we all have two things in common. We live and we die. That's two things we all have in common. But one thing that we can do to live on forever is what you do forever. Because that live true eternity. Look at Martin Luther King. He's still living spiritually. Gandhi, Nelson Mandela. Look at all of these great leaders. They are living because they gave their time. They gave their life. Mm-hmm. And they give everything. Everything they give. So giving is the key. But Liberia truly, truly needs that because they're a deplorable situation. And I do not. I want to answer your question.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Yeah, I want to answer your question. I want to answer your question. And like I said, I'm not too knowledgeable in whether NGO goes to Africa and they do their job or not. Because I don't want to speak on something that I'm not I don't know too much about. But I do know that presence is significant in Africa as a whole, and even Liberia. But it is significant, and I'm hoping and praying because that they can do a good job.
Yeah, I agree with all those things you said about giving and, mm-hmm. and you know, and everything like that and sharing. And my other show is Archangel of Return to Chivalry. Mm-hmm. I totally believe in it. I got a whole movement that's going throughout the whole world.
I like that.
That follows that same tenet that you're talking and stuff. Like I said, my question was on the NGOs that come into the countries and stuff, and they come under the guise of doing things, and their intentions are probably well founded. But when they get there, they do half work, you know, trying to sew it up because a lot of people really don't have the expertise of what they're doing, so the structural infrastructure falls apart.
That's true.
You know, and you know, if you're coming over to America seeking the educational, are you doing this in other countries too, like England? England has a big presence in Liberia. Australia?
That's true.
Is your organization?
Our organization, we actually got our 501c3 January of this year.
Mm-hmm.
And we are just a newly established organization. And we'll be having our launching program at 60 Mason Street, Redemption Christian Church, in Worcester, Massachusetts, 60 okay. Mason Street. So we are a new organization. The goal is to help children in Liberia and to expand it worldwide. That is the goal. But right now we are helping in Liberia because Liberia, the children of Liberia truly, truly yearns for education. And your presence, everybody, whoever is listening, wherever you are, studio right now, Nate, everybody, your presence will validate that a child who learns today can lead Africa, Liberia, and the rest of the world to a better tomorrow. So.
Well, I agree with that. My question was more so is your program targeting the people in England, people in Israel?
Anybody who wants to help better the next generation of leaders, it is targeted there.
And I don't think his program is in England.
I don't know. That's why I asked.
No,
it's out of Worcester. And it's just started, and it's based in Worcester. Yeah, I think it's based in Worcester. Strictly based from a connection from Worcester to Liberia. That's it. Yeah. So I guess in the future,
I asked that because my thing worldwide.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
It goes everywhere.
But still, and then again, I want to go back to my question of leaders. I think leaders is a compile of a bunch of different characteristics. Mm-hmm. And for one thing that I always believe, and I know Nate might, y'all know, one, leaders take the blame and they give credit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the other one is, what do you call it when you give of yourself?
Yeah.
You're always giving of yourself, that passion of making other people happy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, those are like real leadership qualities to me.
Definitely.
That I had to learn and see over the years, because you would think that the leader is the one who just talks.
I
really don't do much, but just talks, got an opinion.
Yeah, I hear the talk. I want to speak for you just for a minute. What the leadership he's talking about is like enforced development, mm-hmm. force multipliers.
Yep.
A leader would take somebody and he educates that somebody, and that somebody educates somebody, and mm-hmm. that somebody educates somebody, and
discipleship.
From this,
discipleship.
Yeah, just like that. And I think that's what he's talking about for leadership. Because the greatest accomplishment of a leader is not to reproduce yourself, but to make something that's better than what you are.
Yeah, the greatest leader, in my opinion, is Jesus Christ. He gave his life for us. That is the greatest leader. It is truly the greatest leader. Can you, no man have given their life for our cause. And that's the greatest leader. And we are working to continue his what he's did. Going from one place, spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. Giving his time, himself, his life to others. We also want to spread and give our time to the next generation of leaders in Liberia. Education. Using it through our faith, through our hard work and perseverance, we truly believe that that is the greatest. But to answer your question,
I agree.
Jesus is the greatest leader in my opinion.
Oh, I think Jesus is a great leader, except if you're Jewish, he was. He was the greatest terrorist for the Jews. He usurped their whole religion. So, I mean, I think worldwide Jesus is definitely the greatest leader that ever have been.
And other than kids in Liberia, that's a big thing. I know we have what's his name? Lord,
Keefe.
Idolo Finney. What's his name? Idolo. He does refugees. Mm-hmm. I know because right now I think it's, and I have my uncle argue me down as far as this segregation. Should we go back to segregated times? And I think that's what it leans to. But I think everything right now is so fast paced and everybody is like in the same melting pot. What do you think about just in general young kids from African descent, you know, just young kids that come from Africa or have heavy African culture, you know, being in the same pot with Liberia, you know what I mean? Because I know one thing I've noticed is, and I don't want to talk too much, is that yes, Africa has a whole bunch of different countries in it.
That's true.
You know what I mean? So it's like every little part of Africa wants to be important and they need to be important. Mm-hmm. But if we're talking about kids in general, I think, you know, wouldn't you think all the kids should go in the same pot together?
I truly believe all the kids should go, every children, regardless where they live in America, in Massachusetts, everybody is. But like I stated earlier, you cannot go into another man's house and clean his house until your house is clean. So that's why we are starting in Liberia. So education is important. Whoever is trying to empower the next generation through education, there is a lot of good people out there doing an amazing job helping and trying to bring change. And I believe that if we all, the next generation, young men and women around the world, just working to bring change to Africa, our generation right now, whether you are in America, or whether you are in America or whether you are in Africa, it doesn't matter where you are. If you believe that change can happen, you just need to act and start doing it. But I truly believe all children around the world deserve education.
This might seem like a dumb question, but I guess
No question is dumb. No question is dumb.
But Lies. What gender population are you really targeting, men or women?
Well, I said no question is dumb, but I have to.
Oh, I love that one.
I have to take that back for a little bit. But we're targeting children as a whole, children everywhere. We got it. There's no gender specific.
I don't know.
No. There is no sexism in that. Both boys and girls. I want to just speak to this a little bit. The empowerment of women that is going around the world, it is a beautiful thing. Yeah. The fact that we have a female running for president, it is a beautiful thing. I mean, the world is staring in a direction that I believe is beautiful, but we as the next generation, who is presently living in this, what you guys are doing right now, speaking about current issue, that's amazing. That's what should be going on. Young men and women talking about things that is important to our society so that we can have a voice that will empower the next generation. They can have a bigger voice than we can. But just to not go too political on that, I just want to say, do not forget, 60 Mason Street, Redemption Christian Church, that's where we're going to be having our launching program. Do not forget.
I want to ask you a dumb question.
I like that.
I don't know if I'm going to be dumber than troops or not. But my question's along the lines of, you know, I don't know how that place in Africa is, because, you know, it's a big, you know, so the kids that got stolen from Nigeria's education program, are you faced with, you know, those type of elements in Liberia?
Liberia is filled with a wide range of elements. I mean, from health issues, to education issues, to exploitation. Liberia is faced with a wide area of issues. The problems stretch far and wide. I mean, like, literally, it stretches far and wide. There are so many different problems that Liberia face right now, but we truly believe in order to tackle that problem is through education. But just to go a little bit, I don't think I speak a little bit about this. Liberia was founded in 1847 by free American slaves. So slave that came from the United States. That's when Marcus Garvey was trying to do the established people, like black people should go back to Africa.
Yeah. Which I agree with him at that time.
Exactly though. So that's what he was doing at that time. So black people went back to Africa, and when they did that, that's how Liberia was founded. And so, like, me having the name Joshua Kennedy, that's a name because a lot of slaves who went back had slaves' names. Mm. That's how I got that name. Technically, if I was in Liberia and born and raised, my name wouldn't be like Kennedy. But because of the ancestral street, I went back to Africa, that's how my name is Kennedy today. But just to speak about that, we are supporting all children in Liberia. And the problem Liberia faces right now, it is extremely critical. Two civil wars, Ebola mm-hmm. situation that just happened. It impacted Liberia significantly.
So these individuals are gonna kind of be hip to that. Like their safety is gonna be in jeopardy if they go over there, even if they're trying to do something positive. So
that's real.
How do you convey that in a way that's gonna be like, you know, inspiring for the kid to say, hey, all right, let me do this?
That's an excellent question, my brother. And just to go over what my brother just asked me a question recently about what is leader. Leadership is somebody who's willing to sacrifice and give their mind, their body, and soul. Mm. There's a lot of great leaders who do that, but like I'm saying, Liberia, a lot of people have this conception about Africa and how when you go to Africa, there would be the gorillas, the this, the that, all these stuff. People in Africa are civilized, very, very civilized. They dress like you and I, they go to school like you and I, but it's just like in like third world country like Liberia, where the situation is there, they are in dire need of help. That is the reason why we are working for education. But people who are going back, they will be safe. Ebola is not in Liberia anymore. And before you travel to Africa,
I wasn't even talking about Ebola. Ebola
is not in Africa. The civil war has stopped in Africa for many years. And there's many NGOs around Worcester, around Massachusetts. If you guys are listening, please contact Learn Today, Lead Tomorrow, or visit our website at ltltliberia.org. and try to get in contact with us and see how you can better help and work with us to bring betterment to the next generation of leaders in Africa.
I'm wishing you all the luck in the world. I hope your organization grows and grows and grows and people funding lots and lots and lots of money. I'm sure you're going to reach out to the people from Seattle. What's their name? The old rich people live up there. Melinda Gates. Their organization's all over there, and they still got money that they have to spend because they're coming up on ending their 20-year cap that they put on their organization for educational means throughout the world and stuff. So, especially when it comes to women, and good thing that you take in both genders, you know. So that's a good thing. So there should be a lot of money out there for you to be able to touch into and get those schools built, get those kids educated. I'm sure they're much more educated than some of the kids here. They speak how many languages? Three?
There's almost 16 languages.
Yeah, they speak a couple.
But it's not about, don't get me wrong, if anybody can help financially, we truly appreciate it.
Yeah.
But you can also give pencils, you can give books, you can give computers. There are so many ways people can help. You can give your time. Or you can go to our website and try to bring awareness to it. If you know somebody who can help us, let us know so we can collaborate. I understand financial donation is amazing and that helps awesome.
So you're really just a real startup grassroots organization.
We are a startup grassroots organization.
They just put the seeds in.
We put the seed in and we're fifth and believe that in the big guy upstairs, we truly believe that our organization will flourish and touch many people, many children's lives, and bring significant change.
Is there any other organization doing something in Liberia that you're connecting with too that you can kind of like partner with?
There is a lot of organization even in Worcester. There's many organizations in Worcester, in the Massachusetts. I was actually, when we first started the organization, I was a little bit, we was afraid because our co-founder, Ms. Keba Sendo, we was afraid thinking that we don't want to, because we don't want to compete with anybody. We don't want to do the same thing other people is doing. But when you have a passion, that passion to do something, it just keeps knocking at you, that it's just kind of hard to resist. But there's a lot of other organizations, I think almost about 80 organizations, even just in Worcester alone, that is working in Liberia. So, but we haven't connected with a lot of any organization as of yet, but we are looking forward to connect with any organization around Worcester and far or near, so you guys can get in contact with us, www.ltliberia.org. Please, and don't forget, December 3rd, 60 Mason Street, Worcester, Massachusetts, the Redemption Christian Church. Please come and support, because every children need your help. Every children, giving is the greatest thing you can do.
Yeah. Hey, I don't want to cut you off, but I know that our time's running down and everything, and I just want to give a little shout out to the veterans and stuff, because Veterans Day is this Friday, and I think that, you know, not just because I'm a veteran myself, but I think that I shout out to the veterans and everybody. Just go by and see some veteran. They're probably going to have a parade up there near the armory or something like that. So if you have it in your time or something like that, just to go by and shake one of the veterans' hands and give him, not even shake his hand, because that's the old aristocratic bougie pony and stuff. Just throw your arms around him. You know, you see the veteran coming, put your arms out when you're about 5 feet away and just walk together and give him a big old giant hug and stuff. Yeah. Him or her. I think that would be good. So I want to give a hoorah to all the veterans out there, all you veterans.
Yeah, and let me get let me get a shout out to Dred St. Michael's that couldn't make it here. Dred. Hope everything's out with your family, Dred. Shout out to you, Mike. And people, vote on what you feel. Don't get caught up in the scare tactics, and things might be real, man, but like I think that America has to be honest on who they voting for, and then we'll let the chips fall where they lay, and then after that we'll decide. People can say, hey, you know what, I think that third party's gaining momentum, maybe I'll vote for the third party next year. Or maybe not. Maybe this won't be good results. I don't know. But, you know, vote for what you want to vote for. Don't get scared and whatever. If you think charter schools are good, vote no and vote yes for charter schools. If you think public schools need more money, vote yes for the public schools. Do what you got to do, but go vote.
No, don't vote for drugs.
I like to
vote for number 4. Definitely. Yes. I'm down with that.
Vote yes. Matter of fact, I'm going live for number 4 later on today on my Facebook. So check me out on Facebook for question number 4. We're going to be having a celebratory party, dig this.
I won't be there. Just let you guys know. Yeah. I won't be at the celebratory party.
Yo, listen. On the topic of leaders, shouts out to Josh for coming. Learn today, lead tomorrow. We need a lot more leaders out there that ain't so credit hungry. You know, have a lot of organizations and a lot of so-called leaders out here in this world. They all they want is the credit. They don't want to do no work.
Plug in
Missy's. Yep. So now that's what I'm about to do right now. We're feeding the homeless Sunday. Ladies of the Hills, 1000 Watts, down at 1000 Watt Barbershop, which is on 848 Main Street. Donations, the latest she's taking donations is Thursday, the 10th. If you need to get in contact with her, give her a call at 508-753-1301. And again, this Sunday, we're feeding the homeless.
And that's 1 to 5 p.m.
Yeah, 1 to 5.
Tell them about she'll be on Archangel.
Yeah, and
on Facebook on Friday.
Yes.
You can catch Missy talking about her feeding the homeless on facebook.com/Archangel. I'll return to chivalry on Friday, anytime on Friday. Her interview will be up on Friday.
And thank you for coming, Josh. Come back later on when things are going good and let us know how things are going, all right? Shout out to Josh Kennedy.
Thanks, my wife. Good show, fellas. Learn.
That was good. I like that.